Those of you that were there may remember when I led my very first service in the Danziger Chapel back in May. I started by acknowledging that as beautiful and warm and intimate as that space is, from the other side of the lectern, it's a little bit scary. Standing up here tonight, I'd like to amend that observation. Standing behind the lectern in the Danziger Chapel is scary, but this is terrifying. 5 years ago, I led my very first Rosh Hashanah service as a rabbi in a community about 4 hours south from here, Congregation Anshe Chesed in Vicksburg, Mississippi. Temple Israel is 166 years old, one of the oldest congregations active in America. Anshe Chesed is older. And like Temple, on Rosh Hashanah, you see the entire congregation there. That first service I led in a sanctuary filled with 30 people. I remember looking out from that bima that night. I saw 30 people interspersed among over 100 empty chairs. Several years later, I went back to Anshe Chesed. At that point, they had recently sold their building, and they were in the process of clearing out what was left. Standing in what had been the rabbi's study, the president of the congregation handed me this atarah. At first, I politely declined, but he was insistent. "You're going to have more use for this than we will." Reluctantly, I took it, and I was not quite sure what I would do with it or if and when I was ever going to wear it. But if you'd allow me, I would like to wear it now. A little background. I was there serving that congregation in my role as the director of rabbinic services at the Institute of Southern Jewish Life. It's a bit complicated, but in short, my job involved traveling throughout the South to dozens of communities, most of which were small remnants of what they had once been. But I knew Vicksburg the best, and I'd spent a lot of time thinking about the Jews who call it home. Vicksburg was never a large Jewish community, but in its heyday, it was large enough to have its own B'nai B'rith building, the B'B Club. It was the place to be if you were one of the 467 Jews who, less than a century ago, called Vicksburg home. And that building still stands in downtown Vicksburg, and if you're ever there, it's worth checking out. Make sure they show you the pool in the basement. Why did Vicksburg have hundreds and then perhaps a dozen people today? They are victims of the same demographics that reshaped all of small-town America as populations shifted to urban areas. The growth in Jewish communities of Atlanta, Dallas, Houston, Memphis. Well, someone had to be on the losing end of that. But those empty seats have stayed with me these last 5 years for another reason. They are a warning. What happened there happens everywhere. It happens here. It's just a little harder to see. Tonight, synagogues across this country are holding High Holy Day services as a collective 1,200 hours worth of sermons are being delivered in this moment. More if the rabbi runs long. Regardless, there are fewer people here to hear those sermons this year than there were last year. Next year, there will be fewer still. And this fact, despite the Jewish community devoting over $500 million in the effort to keep American Jews Jewish. $500 million spent to try to engage at most 8 million Jews. And still, despite that effort, the empty chairs increase. It's bad, hard news to hear in a year when we as a people could do without more bad, hard news. In the last year, I don't need to tell you, we have seen not one but two Shabbatot desecrated by the murder of worshipers at the hands of anti-Semites. Closer to home, we have seen anti-Semitic graffiti painted in the middle of UT's campus, and then painted again, and again, and again. And seemingly every day, there is another example to read about some horrific act of hatred directed at our community. And absorbing this onslaught, it has taken its toll on us. In a recent poll, more than half, 54% of American Jews feel anti-Semitism is one of the most important issues facing this country. But these examples, devastating, horrific, unfathomable as they are, they overshadow a larger truth. This is going to be hard for some of you to hear, but I'm going to say it anyway. Despite what we read, despite what has happened to the Jewish community, in general, people like us. They like us. It might not feel that way. We might not feel that way. But the numbers don't lie. In 2014, the Pew Organization surveyed Americans and asked them to rate their favorability toward 9 separate religious groups. Now, technically, it's not a contest. But that being said, we, Jews, we did very well. In fact, we won. The Pew Organization found that Jews are the most liked, most admired, most accepted religious community in this country. That statement is so inconceivably at odds with all we know of our history, both recent and historic and biblical, I know many of us have trouble accepting it. For what it's worth, Pew asked the same question again in 2017, and they got the same result. And again this summer, and again the same result. People like us. I want to point out, it's not all good news. Don't worry, I do have something bad to share. 3/4 of Americans have no idea what Rosh Hashanah is. People might not know much about us, but they like us. And by the way, I can't help myself, in that same survey, 20% of Jews don't know what Rosh Hashanah is. If you get called by Pew next summer, Jewish New Year, that's all you have to say. It's not a trick question, it really is that simple. We can get that number up. There is poetic irony in the fact that this trend of Jewish admiration and acceptance comes at the same time that our numbers are in decline. But I've come to believe those two trends, the acceptance of Jews and waning Jewish participation, they are related. Collectively, as a people, we have almost no experience in our history with being liked, let alone being loved, by our neighbors. It's an inconceivable injustice that our ancestors endured countless generations of oppression and persecution. We joke, you can say it with me, how to summarize every Jewish holiday. They tried to kill us, we won, let's eat. That's funny, but I want us to think about that. There is no other religion that has that joke. It's maybe funny, but it's really horrifying to think that our tragedy is predicated, or our history is predicated on tragedy. But those countless tragedies that we can all name, they have an unintended effect. Those tragedies, that adversity that we faced as a people, they made our communities stronger. 500 years ago, when the first ghetto emerged in Venice, Italy, when Jews were forced to live inside and behind gates that were locked at night, inside those walls, they organized and they supported each other. Make no mistake, they were miserable and they suffered. But they were connected, not because they chose to, not because it was meaningful, but because they had no alternative than to rely on each other in such difficult times. A 2014 study on college students found that when participants were asked to perform an unpleasant task in a group, in the case of this study, it was pulling objects from an ice bath water, they felt more included and more committed to their groupmates compared to control groups who did the same task but without the ice in the water. Building community through shared suffering, it's not a new idea. Militaries, fraternities, they figured this out long ago. In our own community, for those that fast on Yom Kippur, you might appreciate or have felt the solidarity that comes from that small bit of hardship, especially in those afternoon hours as the gates slowly begin to close. To look at someone and know they are experiencing what you are, that is a powerful force. But at the same time, no one has ever said, "I wish there were more Yom Kippurs." Right here, right now, this marks the lowest barrier and the best relations between Jews and their neighbors in millennia. No Jew is compelled by anyone else to be Jewish. No Jew is a member of this community only because it's the only one that will allow them to be in. No Jew is here because they have to be. If you are here tonight, it's because you want to be. Unless your parents made you come here, and I've thought about that, and I don't have a good answer, but Hebrew High, TI High, we'll meet again a week from today, 4:30 at Shelby Farms. Come, we'll talk about it. Please don't be late. But for the rest of us, this is our unprecedented challenge. We must create a community people feel compelled to join, not because someone else is making them, but because they can't imagine not being part of it. Because this community stands on its own merits among the marketplace of experiences open to us as Jews. Creating this is going to require some changes. On the face of it, change is scary, perhaps terrifying, especially if you value and enjoy what you have. And while I have no better ability to predict whether our religion will rise to the challenge than any of you in this room, I find comfort in knowing this is not the first radical change we have undergone. 2 centuries ago, European Jews faced an equally daunting situation. After generations confined to the ghetto, the walls came down. Democracies took hold in Europe, and Jews found themselves invited for the first time to live inside society, to go from other to neighbor. From this came the beginnings of the Reform Movement, a movement that quite literally and radically reshaped Judaism. And if it's one thing you remember from tonight, let it be this. We are Reform Jews. No ED at the end of it. Not reformed. And it is an important distinction. Reform without the ED is an active, ongoing process. The change does not stop. For those who lament the Reform Movement doesn't look anything like it used to, you're right. And that's the point. We can see examples of this reshaping here at Temple. Connect TI, which was recently identified by the Union for Reform Judaism as one of 7 successful young adult programs in the entire country. In its report, we can see some of the keys to the success. A director and a board who are here tonight personally connect with the members. They have programs that include socialization, but they don't end there. Contrary to popular belief that it will scare people away, when we have events that feature meaningful educational and religious content, people come. We have events that take place at Crosstown, at Temple, throughout the city. And perhaps most of all, a trusting relationship that allows the leadership of the group rather than the leadership of the temple to set the agenda. Our challenge is, you don't stay in your 20s and 30s forever. So I'm told. People age out of Connect TI, but they do not age out of wanting the community such a group provides. For better or worse, the URJ's report acknowledges that this is a common challenge. We have found success in this age group and shown what an intentional religious community that meets the needs of members can be. We must now focus on what comes next. And I must say the stakes are high. If there is nothing to offer the future generations, there is no reason for them to stay. They are free to go, freer than they have ever been. Adapting to the needs of an ever-changing society is one challenge we face. It's one driven by our leadership, our staff, our movement. But the other change, it's going to need all of us. Several years ago, I walked into a synagogue, not as a rabbi, but as a congregant. Walked into a congregation where I knew no one, and where I came totally alone. I was there because I was wrapping up my time in rabbinical school in Los Angeles, and I realized that of the dozens of synagogues within 10 miles of where I lived, and in LA, that is less than 2 hours' drive. I'd been to hardly any. I resolved I'd try a different one each Shabbat for my last summer. As the weeks went on, I realized two things. First, there is a wide variance in the quality of oneg offerings. We're doing very well here, by the way. And second, more importantly, the task was making me miserable. Not because anything was wrong with any of the synagogues I went to. They were wonderful, warm, lovely places. Rather, it was the act of walking through those doors, alone, into a room where I knew nobody, that was causing me so much angst. I started tonight by saying standing up here is terrifying. It still is. But this is far less daunting than walking through those doors. The experience reminded me of a conversion student I once met, a man in his 80s. He had been thinking about becoming Jewish for some time, most of his life. So why now? He had moved, he said, and every day he had driven by the synagogue on his way to and from work. Every day, for 20 years. 20 years he came within feet of the front door of the synagogue, but he could not summon the courage to step inside. Here was a World War II combat veteran, terrified to walk through that door. Perhaps that is an extreme example, but perhaps not. There is no way to know how many people drive by our doors wanting to come inside, but ultimately never do. And if they never come, we can never greet them. But let's remember, for those that do make that step, that is a courageous act. There are people here tonight among us who are here for the very first time. Welcome. And for those who are watching tonight, because you are not yet ready to take that step, we are here to welcome you when you do. A synagogue in Hebrew is called a Beit Knesset, a house of gathering. For many, walking into temple feels like walking into your own house. And I realize for you, it can be hard to imagine how it could feel like anything else. But I will ask you, if you've ever had the experience of walking into someone else's home, trying to find the silverware cabinet in someone else's kitchen, you know how disorienting that experience can be. No matter how nice the home is, if it's not yours, it's different. I use the example of a convert. In Hebrew, the word we use is ger, stranger, someone who comes from the outside. But Jews by choice are not the only ones who can feel like outsiders. There are those that feel they are too young or they're too old. There are those who feel that they must have missed that day in religious school when everyone else learned when they're supposed to stand up and when they're supposed to bow. Everyone feels like they missed that day, by the way. There are those who are single. There are those who feel they live in the wrong zip code, or those who feel they have the wrong kind of job, or those that have no job. There are countless reasons walking into this community can feel hard. And yet, people still do. So maybe the question we should ask is not, why are so many seats empty, but why are so many full? What compels people to come at all? Directly stated, what compels you? Why are you here? If I can attempt to offer my own explanation, I would say it's because Judaism offers something you cannot get anywhere else. It offers a spiritual community guided by holiness, promoting of debate, open to change, rich in tradition, free of judgment, and active in the world outside its doors. These ideals and so many more compel people to come. They compel us to be or create a world in which we are the most admired religious group in this country. But it's not enough to compel people to stay. That is our job. And when I say us, I do mean clergy and staff, but that is not going to be enough. It's up to those here who do see this as their home. What have you done? What do you do? What can you do to welcome those who don't? One of our most cherished precepts is the notion that we are all responsible for one another. Whether you act on that responsibility is up to you, but it is a responsibility nonetheless. Let us enter 5780 knowing it's going to look different than 5779. Let us remember that 5781 is going to look different still. Yes, some who sit in these seats today will not be sitting here tomorrow. This is the price we pay for the freedom that we have to choose. But so too may we open our house and invite those on the outside in. May we recognize the Judaism of future generations. It's not going to be the same as the Judaism of the past or even the present. And may we recognize that as the year renews, some of what is meaningful to us, some of what was precious to us, is going to be left behind. And that is not an easy thing to do. Let us accept that nonetheless, and ultimately, hard as that may be to process, this change, this renewal, is a good thing. May our community give us joy. May it give us gladness, comfort, challenges, and growth. And just as our community gives to us, may we in this new year commit to giving back to it. Shana Tova. May it be God's will. Amen.